Well, good afternoon, everyone. If we could take your seats, the refreshments will be available all afternoon. And I want to thank everyone for attending today. And I particularly want to thank our panelists and Sharon Loudon. We have a great afternoon planned for you. And on behalf of the New Jersey State Council on the Arts and the Cumberland County Cultural and Heritage Commission, welcome to Cumberland County. We wanted to, the State Council and the Commission wanted to provide programming to artists that would be meaningful to you. And so we hope that today is a conversation. We're not looking at anything formal. This is really a back and forth conversation, and Sharon will explain the procedure and what she would like to see out of today. And it all revolves around Sharon's book, which you all have, Living and Sustaining a Creative Life. And there will, after the conversation and the facilitation, a Q&A, we will have a reception at the end, and Sharon and Julie Langsam will be available for a book signing. And so relax and enjoy the afternoon. I just want to quickly introduce Sharon. We'll do the more formal introductions. But we have Wendell White, Julie Langsam, Cesar Viveros, and Ken Lee. You may be and probably are familiar with many of them. They all have different expertise, and I'm sure they're going to have interesting stories to talk about. Sharon is from New York and is a Yale grad, and has taken it upon herself to really help artists as much as she can. And I think it's a testament that the book has been so popular that there really is a need for that in our community. So with that, I'll pass it to Sharon.
Thank you, Matt.
You're
welcome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody, for having us here today. And I want to thank Matt and Don, especially, for organizing this and for them putting up with me, because I did live in New York for 25 years, so I have a little edge to me. So, and anyway, please forgive me if I go off the stage. But I'm thrilled to be here, and I'm so excited to have this opportunity to share Living and Sustaining a Creative Life with everybody. And as Matt said, this program today is centered on this book, and I'm just going to give just some highlights of this book before I start to introduce these fine, exceptional artists to the left of me. First of all, this event is the 59th stop on a book tour that I've been doing all over the country since November 1st, 2013. And the book tour has taken on this kind of format where there are several people in an audience and then a panel discussion. And the way the format usually is, and what we'll do today, is we'll have a 45-minute moderated conversation. I'll be asking these wonderful artists some questions that I've prepared them in advance for, and maybe some other ones that I haven't asked them in advance. And then that'll be a warm-up for all of you to ask some questions, and then afterwards you can ask us individually as well questions and have a dialogue with us during the book signing and the reception after this conversation. Living and Sustaining Creative Life came about because when I got out of college, I had $115,000 in debt when I got out of Yale, because my parents did not subscribe to me being an artist. They wanted me to go to West Point because it was free in the military, so that's where I was coming from. So when I got out of college in 1991, $115,000 is now $206,000. That's what it equates to. I paid that off in 10 years through my work. Very proud of that, because it says that mine's not a special case necessarily, because artists contribute to the economy. And I think artists are functional people in the world that do a lot for, and everybody here must subscribe to it because you're here for this conference. Contribute in many ways in how we think about things and how we draw imagination and contribute to other people's lives. But anyway, so what happened was when I had that debt, I noticed that there wasn't a lot of sharing with other artists, and it drove me crazy. I think this book is really therapy for me. I've been teaching for 23 years, and the last 10 years I've been teaching professional development. And in professional development, which means essentially teaching or directing artists how to sustain a creative life, so many artists would come up to me, young artists getting out of school. Now the tuitions are much higher. I think Yale is now $34,500 a year. It wasn't that when I went to college. My education was over the course of 9 years because I just had trouble paying for it, and that's accumulated all of that debt. But anyway, these kids are graduating and they're asking a few questions. They're asking, one, how do we get a gallery? That question drives me crazy. And then the other question is, how do you make a living? Those two questions. Well, I think those two questions should be answered, or at least directed, before they get out of school. But also, I think other artists should be able to give to other artists to be able to reveal how they sustain a creative life. So I chose 40 artists, 19 people from New York, because I was living there for 25 years, 19 people from different parts of the rest of the country, and 2 people from Europe. 21 men, 19 women, had to be that way, sorry guys. And then the other thing is the ages are ages 30 to 66. All the artists were chosen because I knew that they were generous artists that could give to other artists, number one. Number two, all of the artists had interesting stories. They had different points of views. Some essays in the book are more opaque than others, depending on the personality of the artist, and I'll try to read from them today some particular sections. And then some are very transparent, and that they really reveal a tremendous amount. All of them are vast and wide-ranging in the different media that they choose to be able to express themselves with. So I can't define and say there are 15 painters, there are 10 sculptors, what have you. They're just all different media, and I show a picture of everybody's work, one piece, but that doesn't define the whole language. So in some ways, it's an introduction to their work, too. It's also an introduction to a conversation, a bigger conversation, which is why I think this book has been very popular. This is an academic book. It's not a money-making venture. The 8% profit that I get for this book, which is actually pretty average for an academic book, is split all the royalties with all of the contributors. The first royalty check was $10.04 per person. So this is not, we did not do this for money. This is about the goodwill and to be able to help other artists to be able to make culture in this country much stronger. That's my agenda. I'll just say a few other things about this book. The book has been extremely popular. I feel very grateful for that. It's a testament to all the artists that have written in this book, including Julie. She has an essay in this book. And also the need for artists to know information. That's been the biggest thing. We've met thousands of people on this book tour, and the book is in its 5th printing, and I just checked yesterday with the publisher, or the distributor rather, there's only 500 books left in the fifth printing, and so we're going to do, I think, a sixth printing, which is amazing. I've also gotten a contract to do a second book, and that tour will take place in 2017. So anyway, that's the backdrop for this. So now I want to turn our attention to these wonderful artists, and I'm going to introduce you to them. And some of these artists I've just met through, probably they may say, an interrogation on the phone with them. But I think that I try to vet artists that I know that can be very generous and forthcoming. And so they've been prepped for this, and I'm hoping that through our conversation you'll have some ideas so we can continue the exchange in the Q&A after our moderated conversation. And feel free to just raise your hand and interrupt me anytime, because you can tell I talk a lot. I'm going to try not to. Okay, so to my left is Wendell White. Hi, Wendell.
Hi.
And Wendell is, everybody provided me their bios, so I'm just going to read from them, if you don't mind. So Wendell's currently a distinguished professor of art at Stockton University, where he's been on faculty since 1986. He received a Guggenheim Memorial Fellowship Foundation, 3 artist fellowships, the New Jersey State Art Council on the Arts, as well as other grants and artist residencies. His work is included in solo and group exhibitions, public and private collections, and numerous publications, I would imagine, all over the country, I would imagine, correct? He has a book out, it's called Manifest, and it was published this year by Chroma. That's an amazing publisher, congratulations. And it's a publishing imprint of the California Institute of Integral Studies in San Francisco. But I'm sure you can find that book. Again, it's called Manifest, and it's published by Chroma. Thank you so much for being here. Julie Langsam, to the left of Wendell. Julie is best known for her paintings of iconic modernist buildings designed by celebrated architects. She is currently assistant professor at Rutgers University's Mason Gross School of the Arts in New Brunswick, New Jersey. This past year, Julie has had solo exhibitions at the Richard and Dolly Moss Gallery, SUNY Purchase. SPA?
It's a small, actually artist-run gallery in Barcelona.
In Barcelona, that's awesome. The gallery Thomas Jekyll in New York City, and I would tell everybody, write this down, I don't know if you have pen and paper, but, well, you have to write down Wendell's book, okay? And now you have to write down, I hope you guys have something for them to write down. But Julie is having a show on April 30th at opening, and it's free and open to the public. Is he going to have wine? Yes. So, Thomas Jekyll, J-A-E-C-K-E-L, in New York City, if you happen to want to pop in. She's had other solo exhibitions, including at MoCA Cleveland. It's Museum of Contemporary Art in Cleveland. She's also shown in Iceland and other galleries in New York City in the past. She's the recipient of the Paul Krasner Foundation Award and represented many numerous collections throughout the United States. Welcome, Julie. Wonderful. Cesar Viveros, nice to see you. Nice to meet you in person. Thank you for being here. With more than 15 years creating public art in the United States and in his native Mexico, Viveros has been collaborating with the City of Philadelphia Mural Arts Program since 1997. So there are many examples of his work throughout the city. So you can probably tell. Can you tell us where there are, just briefly? Give me like two.
One in Bryland.
Oh, awesome. So maybe you can ask him later where it is. Or is there a place where we can find that online?
Of course. But if you just drive from Bryland, it's across the street from the market, the Amish market.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
You see a mural. I think that's the only mural on like that scale.
In Bryland, probably. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, one in Bridgeton, too.
Bridgeton, right.
The center of town is one, and on 249 is the second.
Have you guys stalked him or something? Is that how you know
about him? Yeah, we stalked him.
Yeah, that's it. That's what are you going to say?
The Bridgeton one is at the crossroads of Laurel and Commerce.
Wow. You guys have camped out there, I think.
Yeah. Actually, I have to say, we painted together.
You did? Yeah, oh, that's how. Okay, now we really know. That makes me feel better versus, let's say, stalking or something.
If I can show off a little bit, I just got a call last week about, that's why it's not my resume. I was selected to paint the mural to receive the Pope coming to Philadelphia.
Oh, wow.
So thousands of people will be painting that.
We can talk about that later. Okay, so Cesar's public work has been inspired by the communities he's served throughout the years. He's become a voice, allowing him to create documentary work, articulating individual stories for a broader audience. So that's wonderful. How cool is that? Really, did you just arrange that news to happen right before you would come here? Or did you hold it back for this?
I held it back.
Yeah, that's it. Okay, Ken Leap. Can I call you Ken?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, thanks. I already just did. Is an architectural glass designer. What does that mean, architectural glass? I get worried about artists naming themselves a little bit. So tell me, because that means the frame is really small.
It means all the work that I do is related to architecture.
Okay.
So it's site specific.
With glass. Okay. He's known for his public art installations throughout New Jersey. He's an ambassador artist for the Wheaton Arts and Cultural Center in Millville, where he's maintained his primary studio since 1994. He's been also an artist in residence at the Glen Kane Museum in Bryn, Athens, Pennsylvania, is that correct?
That's correct.
And teaches stained glass at the Bryn, Athens College. He's currently the college's director of building arts, a program which offers craft-based training in the decorative arts. Would everybody please put their hands together and welcome these exceptional people. Okay, awesome. It's so great to moderate because then I don't have to talk about myself. So then I can turn to you guys. Okay, so we're going to get started with, so I've introduced everybody briefly. Oh, is there a problem? I speak really loud. You guys.
There. Oh,
speak loud and clear. You guys should take your last name.
There we go.
Okay. Can everybody hear these guys okay?
We did the same?
Well, you did. You said a little bit, right? You laughed, hopefully. We'll keep laughing. I'm going to just say that I want to ask everyone, and I'm going to bounce around, because honestly, I don't know about you guys, but panel discussions, we go all in a row and everybody's waiting for the next person, drives me crazy. So I'm just going to bounce around. So Ken, I'm going to start with you. I'm going to ask you to describe briefly, so I told everybody to be brief so we can get in as much information, you know, how you sustain your life, just briefly. Don't talk about your artwork per se. We're just talking about the bolts and the brass tacks. It's not to say that this conversation isn't about everybody's work. It's really, that's for another conversation. It's really about the inside skinny of how artists, as these people are examples of how they sustain their life. And also, I'm interested in the nuts and bolts, but also how, in the process in which you sustain your life, how you give to other artists as well.
Let's see. I guess the majority of the income that I have is generated from my work.
Can you speak up a little bit?
Majority of the income that comes from my work is I do public art projects and I do commission work. So I early on made the decision that I wasn't going the route of exhibiting work in a gallery. I was always trying to find a client that wanted to make something. So that has helped me along the way. I was approached pretty early on in my career by other artists that wanted to study the techniques that I do in glass painting, which is an architectural stained glass technique. And I started to teach classes out of my studio space at Wheaton Arts. And then I was able to begin to find other opportunities to teach at, began to be invited to teach other places. I did receive a fellowship from the New Jersey State Council on the Arts at a very pivotal time in my career. I had gone to the Rhode Island School of Design, and when I graduated, I had had a background in watercolor painting and was exhibiting through some local galleries. And my dad was looking at the fact that I wasn't making any money, and he said, you should go back to doing watercolor painting, because I know that was something you were able to sell. And I felt very strongly that I was supposed to be doing stained glass. So I had an opportunity to apply for a fellowship from the State Arts Council. And when I received that money, and I received, it was an $8,000 fellowship. This was back in, probably 1989, around that period. So that was really a lot of confirmation for me that that was the door opening and I was going in the right direction.
So
that was really helpful.
Okay, but how long ago was that?
In 89.
Right, that's a long time ago. So tell me how you sustain your life briefly now.
So what I do now is I teach at Brennathan College. I also continue to, majority of my income comes from public art projects.
Wendell. Thank you, Ken. Wendell, can you just tell us briefly how you sustain your creative life and then also how you give to other artists within that?
Sure. So that's a good connection, I think, with what Ken ended there, which is early on, and a little differently maybe for me, early on, I had the opportunity to have a close mentorship with faculty in my graduate program. And during that process, I decided that an academic life was going to be a life that would strike an ideal balance for me to interact with artists, a young artist on a regular basis, to help and interact with as a faculty member, but at the same time, have the support and the overall structure that comes from the academic institution that says, you know, like, here's your paycheck, but also here's some flexibility in terms of your schedule, in terms of things that you're doing professionally, and things that you're doing to sustain your artistic practice, and that was going to be directly connected to what I did for a living. That the paycheck that I got was tied to actually a requirement in my contract, which says that I will maintain professional activity, so that it was already built into that process. So it seemed to me like a great way. And even though it's not really as accessible for everyone, it was something that I started to pursue. It took me, you know, 5 years after graduate school to, you know, land the particular position that I am in now.
Okay, so through teaching is created sort of a place for you to have outreach, but also that requirement of professional development. But some people, when they teach, that is a big range of what that really means.
Right.
And also the requirement of professional development is not necessarily
fulfilled all the time, right?
Or minimally considered. Right. So it says to me that you really took advantage of that.
Absolutely. I mean, I saw that as an opportunity.
As an opportunity.
To do the things that I wanted to do. I knew I had some early on experiences with commercial opportunities and different things that just didn't suit the kinds of ideas that I wanted to develop as an artist, and so this was a place where I could develop my ideas. And I also, you know, found that over time, I don't think I knew it at the beginning, but over time, I found that other activities related to that were also really reinvigorating for me. So becoming involved in the national organization that was connected to my discipline, and working and supporting and volunteering for those efforts to help build a constituency in the community around a particular discipline and advance scholarship in that area and make a contribution first as a volunteer, eventually always as a volunteer, but first just as a volunteer and then eventually as a board member. So I always have been, I'd say for at least 30 years, contributing time above the time that I spend teaching and doing that activity to various boards.
Wonderful. Thank you. What?
Do you think it would be, I think there are a few people having...
Yeah, why don't we pass around a microphone?
Pass around my...
Is that all right? So, Cesar?
I think they're here to be fine.
Right, because I'm loud and clear. That's my last name. Can we take two of them then?
Yes.
And that might be more helpful. So, Cesar and then Julie. No, do I really need one? I don't think I need one. Thank you. And it's good. We don't have these obstructions. Now you can really see us, right? Okay, Cesar, briefly tell me, so you don't teach, which is interesting too. And not to say it's not interesting, you know, I do too. I teach too as part of my living. But it's interesting because you don't. But you, in some ways, you teach in different ways, just as a crossover through the public works that you do. But so it seems as though that you sustain a creative life through these commissions. But can you be more specific as to how you get them?
Sure. Before the year 2000, I used to earn my living by painting all the people murals. I've been painting murals for many years, but before the 2000 year, I worked really hard for this artist, and I was happy, but I know that I wasn't like that happy as I should be. So then, after the 2000 years, I started getting my own commission, my own designs, and to the proposals, and then I got offered, and that's how I started making my name out there, and kind of like showing my style and everything. Since then, I've been pretty much doing that. It's a job I love, I like, and I feel confident, it gives me so much satisfaction. And through the years, that's how it sustained my life. But it's a constant work, not just painting or producing or this,
right.
But also it's a lot of time invested on looking for the opportunities. There's a huge list of cover artists,
right.
Different media,
right.
So I have to make sure that I have to submit. In order to get like 5 or 6 large commissions that will help to make my living, I have to apply for 50.
Exactly.
And do not have time consuming
it.
So it's so much time that you have to spend all the time doing that. So that's basically how I do it. Now, the view of my work, honestly, I feel lucky, I feel blessed that I developed this way of working where I do a lot of preparation, but then it's the people living around, anything that has to do with the world, with the surrounding area, that interests people, as part of this curiosity, they come, and they want to find out more, and they are taking up actually painting, you know.
Which is fantastic.
So it's great, it's a nice exchange.
It's great. And Julie, so you teach, but you also like curate exhibitions.
I have a question.
Sorry, sir, I did not see you.
Well, how did he get the commission for the Pope's visit?
How'd you get the commission for the, can you be brief about, give us the nuggets, how you did it?
Sure.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Who's we?
All the artists who heard that the Pope was coming,
right,
showed interest.
Yeah.
And then was this consensus. Then the diocese funded the mural program to create this piece of work. So then they show his life, a pleasure to many different artists. And they narrow, the people who have to decide, they narrow the list and, to three artists.
Three finalists.
Then we have to submit a design.
You had to submit a design.
So you have a few days to submit the best you could. And it was 10 weeks. I have to stop everything. I have to just, like, once I lose another chance to get other jobs, just to be able to submit. Because the only thing that, at the end of the day, what I believe that is, would give me a chance to get a job was the design, because the design was going to be seen by the people who had to design.
And just
so it doesn't matter the connection, it doesn't matter who you know, which I think that's a good thing.
Yeah.
That kind of thing is to get other jobs. In this case, there was no way, but you have to choose. It's like boxing, you have to be the other guy. I mean, in boxing.
Where is that going to be?
They selected a former public school, but now it's a part of the diocese, because now it's going to be a Catholic school. It makes more sense. It's going to be in the neighborhood. It's going to be huge. About 1,000 people will be paying along with the Pope.
That's great.
But going back to the point is then they get the chance to show or design and talk about it, and after that they get the call to the person who...
That's great. We can get all the other details after. I really want to hear from you, but thank you for your question. So Julie, can you tell, so you teach, but you also curate exhibitions, you developed a visiting artist program, the Cleveland Institute of Art. Can you talk about all the things that you do?
Well, first I think I want to say that one of the biggest things that I decided when I got out of graduate school is that the most important thing for me was to have enough time to work in the studio. So when I started thinking about what kind of jobs I could get, they were things that paid the most amount of money for the least amount of time. And they weren't necessarily the most attractive jobs. So for instance, I waitress for 15 years. And you know, those are the kinds of things that, you know, parents don't like to hear, but it was really a fabulous way for me to have time in my studio. So just really briefly, I just would take every adjunct teaching job I could get. It's very flexible. If you want to go away on a residency, you quit your job, you come back, you get another waitress job. Really easy. My priority has always been my studio. So I'm extremely lucky to be able to teach full time. It's not something that most art students can look forward to even now. So it's people have to sort of cobble together other ways of making a living. But to your point about sharing with other artists, I like to curate shows that sort of investigate subjects that are beyond my own studio practice. Things that, you know, are ideas that I've been thinking about, but they're not necessarily relevant to what I'm making. And so I've curated shows. I was on the board of a nonprofit space in Cleveland, Spaces. I ran a visiting artist program. I invited a lot of artists to come through the city of Cleveland. And I feel it's really important to give back and have a community. And it helps me, it enriches me, otherwise I'm sort of in a bubble and you're constantly rethinking the same ideas through and through. And it's through this interaction that you really, you know, grow.
That's great. One of the reasons why I tied those two questions together, you might wonder why that is because the idea of an artist, I think, has changed over the years. I think that many artists have multiple hats. They do many, many different things in the community. And for me, what I've seen too is that artists who, and we're gonna talk about what success means, but artists who are, quote, successful, and I put them in quotes because success means a whole bunch of different things to different people, depending on what their goals are. And so success But oftentimes you see a lot of people, a lot of artists out in social media or recognized because they have so many multiple hats that people are drawn to them. And oftentimes, artists who give to other artists, it generates not only goodwill, but it also generates opportunities, which then becomes practical and towards sustaining a creative life. And that's why I tied those questions together. So about success, and on the book tour, it's been discussed very often, what is success for an artist today? Like, a lot of people want to just cut to the chase and come right to me and say, okay, what are the keys to success so I can just get the information and walk out and do that? But it's not that cookie. It's not a cookie cutter, just like life is very organic. It's not so straightforward. I can say that if, just briefly, in the book, there the practical keys are the artists who can sustain their creative life well are the ones who have the lowest expenses. That's the number one thing. So if you can't afford to be in New York City, don't be there. It doesn't matter as much anymore. Another thing is not to, I always say this too, in my teaching, there's no such thing as rejection. Rejection, it's just a difference of opinion. So if you send work out and it doesn't get accepted at that moment, it's just a difference of opinion, because maybe the next year it'll be accepted. Maybe you'll get that that grant that you guys have received, the council grant. And then the other thing is persistence, that people, artists basically continue to strive, either create opportunities, but they also ignore those differences of opinion and they just keep going. Their energy goes towards their work and then sustaining their creative life in different ways. So I want to pose this to all of you, is that the idea, what is the idea of success for you? And oftentimes in the book tour, it's been recognized too, and in reality of the art world, that the outside of what's being perceived is not really what actually happens on the inside. So if you see an artist who gets a lot of notoriety, they may not be actually making any money, for example. One thing is not necessarily tied to the next. How do you guys, how can you guys define success for yourself? What is that? So Wendell, what is success for yourself? How would you define success for you and for other artists, do you think?
Right. So I think that, you know, that's, in a way, that's a perfect question, because the other piece of it is not just the artist that we see from the outside may not actually, you know, be making that much money, but they also may not be feeling that successful as we perceive them to be, as we look at that other person and think, oh, well, there's somebody who's really successful. I want to be like that person. And if you ask that person, sometimes they feel like, well, I have a whole long list of things that I feel like I didn't accomplish or that I would like to, you know, still accomplish. So that for me, one of the things that I work on for myself is that sense of what success means relative. And so,
what does it mean to you?
So to me, it means striking that balance, and a couple of, and I think that Cesar and you both have touched on this idea that you, as an artist, we make a lot of attempts at something, whether it's the attempts at individual artwork, or the attempts to get opportunities, commissions, grants, exhibitions, all of those kinds of things, and it requires a certain degree, a certain tolerance for that rejection, a certain tolerance for...
Yeah, or a difference of opinion.
Right. But I also fold into that, not just the difference of opinion, I fold into it for myself the idea that I need to listen to those to some degree, not to let them change me, but to listen and think, am I being as thoughtful about my attempts, about where I'm sending my energy, where I'm sending my efforts, as I could be? Because I can, you know, send my energy out in a thousand different directions by applying for this and applying for that and applying for the other thing. And if I'm not thoughtful about whether or not what I'm doing matches up to that, then I may be not maximizing my efforts. I may not be getting the best, you know, bang for the amount of time and energy that I can.
That's a great point. So you're saying that you're thinking of the other person when you're sending out information?
As much as I can, but at the same time, I try not to overthink it. I try not to think that, well, I need to know, I need to have certainty. So I having recognizing and accepting that uncertainty is very important. But having said that, success has been a cumulative process in terms of how I feel about it for myself. I feel that as I look back, I won't say successful, but I feel satisfied with the return that I have gotten on the efforts that I've made. And that applies both to my work and to so-called recognition for work. Because both pieces are necessary. I have to feel that what I've worked on this year or last year or whatever is something that I'm satisfied with. That's a hard one because I have a hard time ending things. But at the same time, I also, you know, want to have a degree of satisfaction. I mean,
that's
I think
great.
It's just a human
sure.
response. I want somebody
right.
to say,
the
yeah, this
part
is
of the
right,
dialogue.
Right, right.
Julie, what do you think?
Well, I mean, just picking up on this word dialogue, for me, that's the most important thing. I do not make a living on my art. I sell a few paintings a year, maybe, possibly, it might cover parts of my studio expenses. But I've always had to support my habit, which is what I call it, you know, like having a, you know, better drug habit. Art habit. But I, you know, I managed to make a living and put money towards what I do. But for me, being an artist is about having a conversation between the artist via the artwork and a broader community. And we as artists are, you know, talking about the times that we live in and the culture that we're in. And as long as I'm having that dialogue through my work, I feel that I'm successful. So what does that mean? That means that I'm showing my work. It's not important, I don't think, that you be showing in the greatest galleries in the world. I've done pop-up shows in someone's studio. I've had shows in New York. I've had shows in museums. I've had shows all over, but I still, the most important thing for me is that if I spend a year working in the studio, that somehow the work is out there and that there's an audience for it. And I'm not really concerned so much about the status mm-hmm. of where that is going to take place and how that's perceived.
That's great. Ken?
For me, I think the most important part of the process that makes me feel successful is when I'm actually just given the opportunity to submit a design, because that is the challenge. And oftentimes I find the hardest part in my work, the times when I don't feel successful, I've noticed people who haven't seen me in a while, or my close friends, they'll come up and people don't usually ask me how I'm doing. They ask me, what am I working on? So if I can't say that I'm working on something, it makes me in that moment kind of question the whole reality of what am I doing. So as long as I always, and I find that I do, if there aren't commissions coming along, I have to find creative ways to manufacture work for myself. Mm-hmm. And usually that's looking for opportunities. Mm-hmm. So the current position, some of the positions that you mentioned that I have, mm-hmm. One of them is I'm an artist in residence with a museum over in Pennsylvania that has a fabulous collection of medieval stained glass. Mm-hmm. And for, I'll talk about Wheaton in a little bit, but for many years I've been an artist in residence at the Wheaton Arts and Cultural Center, and I'm so fascinated about the, I saw the need where people came in and they were so unaware of the history of the medium that I work in, that I found right then was my role in always educating my client, mm-hmm. Or whoever it was, so I would teach them about the history. And I began to do some classes in the medieval style of stained glass, and then I found a museum that had a wonderful collection, and I said to them, would you be interested in me coming and teaching a workshop in glass painting, using your windows as a basis for that? And this museum had never done any kind of public outreach, any kind of programming, so I was sort of the first, and just through that, and being, I think, you know, generous with my time and helping them, you know, giving them my time so that they could further interpret their collection to the public and find new ways to use it, that gave me a lot of credibility within their community. So that made me feel more successful as well. But there wasn't really any money that came from that. It was more opportunities. And when you talk about creative ways to lower your expenses, by being this artist in residence at the museum, I have storage space for some of my materials there. So when I go and I do teach workshops, now I have closets and things that are my closets. So I slowly get footholds, and Wheaton has been a fantastic example of that. The Wheaton Arts and Cultural Center, back in 1994, invited me to, they were doing something very creative. They were kind of downsizing the staffing. They had a building that was no longer going to be used for a food service facility. So they had the great idea to bring in an artist that could demonstrate some aspect of glass that was not already being represented. So I was invited, and that turned into a very long partnership.
Great. Cesar. Let's get back to the question. What is success for you?
I guess I experienced success even before I understood the word, because I feel bad when we associate success with the level of income.
Yes, this is the point of the question, actually.
I wanted to say that for me, success is the feeling, the experience, the moment that I have when somebody recognizes what I do. Mm-hmm. Especially when I start doing like small clay pieces or little paintings. Everything started really funny. Oh, that's the beautiful piece I ever seen. Everybody's kind of encouraging. And out of the circle of your family, as you start growing up, you know, there is always people, your teachers. So for me, it's that feeling that persists today. I guess that's kind of what motivates me to share, to do this type of work, this public art, because it's exposed out there. So the years, I think that define my life. I feel successful when I feel that more people is able to see my work, and when more people like my work. So it's a matter of this perception. So it's a matter of expose this that you have as an artist, expose it out there. So the more people that you expose it to, is the, I guess that's the level of success. I would personally feel.
Okay.
So I think that then one thing leads to the other one. How am I going to be able to do that? Big effort, a lot of sacrifice, and try to be innovative, try to do things that you know. But this is a problem for everything. There is a market for everything. So it's a matter of do the things that you like the most, but also try to think who do you want this to see your work.
Right, audience for your work.
Yeah.
But one thing that the panel did not say, which I will say, is that I think success too is the longevity of doing what you want to do in your life. How many people in this world do things that they don't want to do for their whole life? The gift of being an artist is to be able to do what you want to do in your life and knowing what that is. That's a huge gift. And I think a lot of artists lose that thought or that fact because they get swept into the difficulty sometimes or the challenges of sustaining a creative life. So with that, I'll say that to just the next thing I want to talk about and getting closer to our Q&A, so I hope all of you are thinking of some questions that you might want to ask. But I want to talk about what are the barriers and obstacles that you think an artist goes through, and what are they to thrive and to actually make a long career and a long life as an artist? So Julie, do you want to start?
It's pretty simple. Time and money.
Time and money.
Time and money.
But how do you get the money? So like, how do you get the cash? That's a big thing.
You know, I have been teaching for close to 30 years, so I've seen lots of different generations, including my own, grow up and make their way through the art world. And people have, you know, you hit the nail on the nose when you spoke about longevity.
Yeah.
And I say to my students, 5 years out of school, you're going to look around at your graduating class, people are not going to be doing it anymore. And the more time goes by, the fewer people can keep making art. And lots of things, you know, lots of life decisions come into play in having that happen. And that it's not necessarily a bad thing. But to go back to the idea of success for me, and I tell my students this, is if you're still doing this 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 30 years from now, if this is something that you can do for your life, you're successful. you can keep a studio practice alive. So how do you make money? You make money working in restaurants. You make money doing commissions. You make money teaching. You make money bartending. I have students who are ice sculptors for big caterers. I have
That's
students,
awesome.
I mean, I have students, a lot of them do construction. They do art handling. They do photography.
Right.
They take photos of other people's work.
Right.
I mean, there's lots of ways to make a living and still have the time to do what you want to do. But you have to be willing to have a kind of unconventional life.
Right, and we, just a segue, Julie and I have spoken about this too. You have to know what your capacity is. I think you have to know, we spoke about this. Like, what is going to be comfortable for you in that equation? Just as a segue too, we'll get back to this. The three of you all have teaching jobs, but what if you didn't have that? You know, it's not a given, because as you said, teaching jobs now are very hard to get. It's not that an artist goes out gets their MFA and then they get a teaching job. That no longer is the guarantee. So there has to be other ways to sustain a creative life. Do you have a comment about that, or should we keep going?
Well, I mean, I can just say that I've always felt secure. I mean, I don't have a tenure track job, so I always know that if I need to pay the rent, I can go and get a job. Wage system. I mean, it's not a big deal.
Yeah.
But I'm not worried about it, and I've never really worried about it in the sense that I work hard. So if I need some money, I'm going to go out and figure out a way to do it.
Yeah.
And it's not that hard.
Right. It's very true. And especially if you find a job that you feel like fits with your work, essentially, or feel in that even time. Like in your schedule, or that you like to do, or has, like if you like to paint Big Macs, then you work in a McDonald's maybe, or something
well,
like that.
The thing is, you talked about like what is your comfort zone. Some people really feel like they need a steady income, and some people are much more comfortable working freelance. Some people want the flexibility of having a job that they can, you know, quit and then find another quickly, like, you know, doing construction or something like that. You have to sort of go with what makes you comfortable.
Right. So Cesar, so you, what are the obstacles that you have to go through to and barriers to thrive? And then what would you say those obstacles for artists who are here and arts professionals to give them advice on that?
Well, we all know the bigger challenge is to decide how much you can risk in order to be able to
risk
in order to be able to secure that job. That's the job you want.
Yeah.
Honestly, like, it's really hard. Since you have kids and you have a regular job,
yeah,
but it's not the job that you want, but then there is this opportunity to do art, but you don't have the time. And that happened to me. I was working on the food industry when I decided to volunteer to do this meal. So I did my job with the little money that I saved. I said, I have to do it. And it's like volunteering, just volunteering, but I need to show what I do. So I also have to take risk. And that's how I show what I have, and that's how I got high.
Mm-hmm.
I went to start producing other people, you know. Until that point, I wasn't doing exactly what I wanted to do. I mean, I loved the job and everything, but it was I decided to be able to offer my own design. So even that, and I would say 2000, because that's the year when I was doing this mega mural on Louisiana for somebody else. And it was offered to me a solo show, a solo exhibition. And I'm like, I've been painting a lot, and I've never done like a solo exhibition. I always collect them, so I like, maybe people like what I do besides walls. And that's another thing, because I have a full-time mural producing the mural, right? But I don't have time to paint other things that I want to paint. So it's the same. Now, painting mural was the job that I didn't want to do, because I want to be able to spend that time. So I didn't have the time, but I didn't want to let the opportunity to go away. So I work from, say, from 8 to 6.
Mm-hmm.
I have plenty of time, you know, in the night time, 24 hours a day, that's plenty of time.
So you're talking about risk and time management, too.
Yeah, because even if you sleep only 2 or 3 hours now, not in this, I was on my average. I was really drunk. I was a full then. So I had to change work
yeah.
full time, mm-hmm. then go back home, do my laundry, cook for myself, mm-hmm. and then start painting because it's a huge room that has to be filled out with new work. Mm-hmm. So after a couple of months, I was able to have a big body of work, canvas and frescoes, and I didn't solve anything. I didn't sell anything,
okay, right?
But I gave me exposure to. When I came to Philly, I brought all my pieces, and I was lucky enough that I was able to sell some of those.
Right.
Even without gallery representation.
It's great.
And then with the money that I saved out, and the money that I brought from Louisiana, I was able to spend time on designing my own thing, and then of course, you know, the program said, I really want this opportunity, I really want to start doing my thing, I know where I have to come. And then finally, they gave me a chance to do the first mural.
That's great. And then you went from there.
And then the next thing would be treat every ward, every commission, every project, every talk, and the first one.
That's great.
After today's day, I say this has to be the best. This has to be the best ever. And again, try new challenge. It's not just mural. I have to take the study myself. I have to study how to do mosaic. I have to do lighting. But I know I cannot stop here. I have to do new things.
So you keep taking those risks to go forward. Okay, Ken?
Yeah, I want you to take this moment to be a little transparent also about how important family is in this discussion as well. Yeah, because a lot of the projects that I did, an architectural building project can take a year to get it and a year to need it. So I would oftentimes see that my income would be very similar.
Right.
I was very fortunate that my wife was a nurse at the Hospital of the University of Pennsylvania. She worked there for 22 years, so
wow.
She had the very steady paycheck, and mine would be down like that. So that helped us really to live. And then, you know, I did a lot of the stay-at-home dad stuff as well to support that. So that was
that's a good nuggets.
Yeah.
But also, can you talk about briefly some barriers that you've gone through, and that, like Cesar was just talking about risk, and then Julie was talking about time and money, essentially, but in getting money all these different ways, which I appreciate that. But can you also say, from your point of view, and also, like, what if you are teaching? Seriously.
Maybe I'm giving the wrong impression about what I get from teaching, because I'm an adjunct. I teach in one class.
Right.
I'm really small. And actually, it's just my wife is retired now from the Hospital University of Penn, just at the time when, you know, I actually rely on the universe to line things up. So it lined things up that, you know, we no longer had health insurance, and then I could get this job and basically just pay for health insurance. So that's
right.
It. So everything else comes
from. Can I ask you about, just clarify?
Yeah.
You can't, I'm sorry to interrupt, but can you make a whole living from adjunct salary?
No.
Okay. I just want to clarify things. Because I think the assumption is, too, that some people think if you're a professor, for example, that this is the perception, that you must make X number of dollars to sustain your life, which I think even a tenured professor at some institutions makes a small amount of money. Teachers across the country are not paid as much as I think that they should be paid. So the reality of things are there must be other ways to sustain a life. So what are those ways?
Let's see.
Just briefly.
well, some of the things that I've gone through are taking, sometimes I will paint for other studios. I'll do that. I'll do conservation and restoration.
Oh, that's interesting.
I consult. I have, in my time, done a lot of volunteer work with other organizations that sometimes will get some money that comes from that. But I think, again, it's the goodwill that you get by being out there and being associated with other places. And places that you find a genuine connection to, either they need you. I always say yes to things. That's one of my problems, is people, you know, over it out because, you know, I just don't say no when somebody asks me to do something. And I also, you know, I don't have like a 5-year, 10-year, 20-year plan. I just kind of go boldly forward, assuming that things will line up. And they tend to do that if you just keep putting yourself out there. So, and I think it's, again, the longevity. The longer that you are doing it, the more people begin to trust what you're able to do. Because I can remember, you know, when I was in my 20s, you know, I would get a new pair of glasses and I'd say, you know, talk to the optician and say, I have to look like my client will trust me with $100,000 of their money to spend.
Wow.
You know? So I had to have a certain persona. I would think about that as well because I would need to be very professional in, you know, especially when you're young. When you're older, me, now I can be a little more flamboyant because people expect that.
Look what you're wearing. Did you think about something like that when you got dressed in a tie today? Or just
Absolutely. I thought exactly what I was going to wear today. So I have costumes for everything.
I actually meant that really rhetorically, but you know, I'm glad you answered that question. Okay, Wendell.
Well, back to the obstacles.
Yes.
I would say that mine have been more personal. I've had some overlapping narratives, I think, with everybody. So I'll just, and I can answer more of those specific ones as well. But that I came from a, you know, very supportive family, a family of people that were professionals, but not one person had done anything in the arts. As well, nobody that I knew close in my immediate family had ever worked in business independently. So this is another kind of component that a lot of, and I have this conversation with my students all the time, is to partly help them to remember that as an artist, you're also a small business person. And developing those skills and understanding what those skills are and how they're related. So I didn't have either one of those things, a supportive family, but I say that to say that I made lots of mistakes and missed a lot of opportunities because of my own, partly ignorance, but also partly just not knowing what the best way was to follow up with the next step. And a lot of it was follow up, I would say, was my earliest, biggest obstacle. And I was fortunate. In one of the things that Julie mentioned was that this idea, I was lucky and I came across and I met with a photographer by the name of Jules Allen at one point who was willing to look at my work. And he was the first person that sort of said to me, well, first thing is that you've got to be in this. I was maybe 23 or 24. And he was like, well, you have to, you know, if you can survive at this until you're 30, then maybe that's the first obstacle. And it was an eye-opening conversation at 23, 24, was because I thought, well, don't you mean like next month I'll be, you know, it's going to happen right away. And that notion that you put a time frame that was much bigger than the time frame that I had in my head really helped to sort of settle me down in a sense in terms of thinking about what I was in for, what the sort of real reality was, and what the long haul was going to be. So, but I would say that, yeah, the one of the biggest obstacles was to learn the lesson of that this was, as much as I was involved in a creative endeavor, I needed to develop skills that were more compatible with operating a small business, and also overcome a kind of personal psychology that sometimes prevented me from really following up on it, feeling like, well, that person didn't, you know, offer me the greatest thing in the world, so, you know, they probably aren't interested, and not recognizing that, you know, in when I was young.
Right, because not that it could down the line,
exactly,
they could be interested,
exactly.
So follow-up is really, really important. So the last question before we open up to the audience, and Wendell, we'll start with you just briefly. If you were to give any advice to artists about sustaining a creative life, I asked all of you to think about this question, what would that be?
Well, I think that I started out with it a little bit in the first part of the conversation, which is, and I go back to this a lot in terms of talking to my students, because this is a conversation I have all the time with them, and it is that ability to endure those disappointments, to sustain the sense that those rejections are not really rejections, but
right,
they are also inevitable, and
right,
enduring them is inevitable, and
right,
if you don't, then that's your biggest hurdle,
right,
that you have to almost get to a point where you say, okay, I understand this is part of the process. I'm not, you know, it's sort of like imagining that you're going to go and get a tattoo and it's not going to hurt. You know, you're going to get something in the end. Not that I have tattoos, but I know that they hurt. And I know that if I wanted one, would have to first say, okay, I recognize that I'm entering into a process that's going to be painful, so that at the end, I'll have something that I think is beautiful or, you know, satisfies me in some way that I like. And that is, you know, a critical part of the process. And it's different for everyone.
Ken, do you want to say?
Yeah. What I tell my students is always give, you know, in really to me it's a client. So give your client more than what they're asking for. And when I first started out doing commission work, I would make the piece that needed to be made, not what the client's budget was. And that helped me to build my portfolio. And so that's the beginning advice that I would give people. Because I never wanted to be in a situation where I had to apologize for my work, saying I didn't do this because they didn't have enough money for it. So I just don't even go there. I find a way to always do something that I'm very, very proud of, regardless of what the client can pay for it.
That's great, Cesar.
I would go for not to classify yourself into some category.
Yes.
I would say always diversify. Make yourself available for everybody. I would say there is no such a thing like a small job. Mm-hmm. Really, sometimes you talk about economical gain, sometimes you make a lot more money doing like a smaller project than just making like a huge mega project. Mm-hmm. I would say that really something that really works is try to expand your network. That's very important.
Community, yeah.
Yeah, I think that sometimes, this is funny story, when I was really young, somebody commissioned me to do a horse. This person owns a horse, he wants a horse. And I couldn't paint the horse. No matter what I tried, I was so bad in anatomy, I couldn't paint the horse. So I went to see my friend, who is like, oh yeah, with my left hand, I want to do it. So he did it. I actually got him on and just passed it to him. It was kind of scary, because I know that sometimes there are jobs that I cannot take because either I don't have the time, I'm busy doing something else, but I still want to be able to not let that opportunity to go. So I always say, you know what, we are a team, I have assistants, or I have co-workers, I have people who are my colleagues. They will be like really, really good for that. So that's how I managed to get this job for somebody else. So everybody can think of what he wants. I'm happy that somebody else is getting the job, someone I know he needed. And he's
going to
do the same for somebody else.
That's great.
This cycle, I think it works.
Julie, the last word on this panel.
Can you repeat the question?
So what advice would you give briefly to artists as far as sustaining creative life?
A couple of things. One is to sort of have the macro view and the micro view. And one is the macro view is what I was talking about earlier, which is that it is a whole lifetime that you have to think about. And there's an arc and a projection, and things go up and things go down, and just to realize that that's part of the process. The other is, I think, setting small deadlines, the micro,
that's great.
You know, having deadlines, like, it doesn't really matter. Like, if you don't have a show coming up, just go and talk to a library or whatever, or open your studio and schedule something so that you have a deadline and you have a way to sort of, you know, force yourself to achieve what you, it's very hard to be in a studio all by yourself with nobody who really cares about what you're doing, you know, frankly. So having goals, having a large view and a small view. The other thing I think is really, we go into this not to make money because very, very, very few artists really make a living, let alone make a lot of money. But the thing is, this joy of having a life that you can sort of create the kind of lifestyle and, you know, be around people that are creative. The idea of the community is really important. So I think that, you know, none of us do these 9-to-5 jobs. I mean, I would just die if I had to do that. And so knowing that I've made this choice in my life and that the people that I surround me with are supportive of it. I have a husband who doesn't even live in the same city as me. He's like, calls me up, I can't talk to him in the studio, I'm in the middle, blah, blah, blah. You know, he understands. And so having a family that is supportive of what you do and the kind of oddnesses of the kinds of hours that we keep and the stress and deadlines and things. I think that's so important.
So I think that is all important, based also too on what you're saying about the small percentage of those artists who actually make a living directly from the work. They are, as Wendell's saying, we're all small businesses. And even if they do make a living directly from it, they do other things in managing that business. And I have to say too, 14 people, women in this book, are mothers in this book, and they talk about how to sustain their life. So I'm just gonna take, before we take questions, I'm gonna read just a couple parts of essays, if you will, and one of them's very funny. So Julie Blackman, who's in the book, if you wanna follow along on page 85, you don't have to, but she's a photographer. Her work has actually been on the cover of Time magazine, her work Real Simple magazine. She's represented, I think, by 6 galleries all over the country. You would seemingly, again, that perception that she's wildly successful. She looks like she would have a yacht and a driver and a chef. She doesn't. She lives in Springfield, Missouri. I've been to her house. She has 3 children, one of whom is autistic. She has a husband who's an academic who's 20 years older than she is. Maybe it's TMI. This is recorded. She won't care. Anyway, so on page 85, she says, it's very funny, she says, unless I'm shooting photography, though, I can usually get a lot done while the kids are in school, sending JPEGs, answering emails, sending invoices, etc. This is a different kind of work than what it takes to actually create. Many people don't realize this. I can never just sit right down and start creating or pick up my camera and wing it without giving a lot of thought first. There's always a period where I'm trying to forget everything else so I can lose myself in creating something new. Sometimes the only place I can keep from being distracted is the car. So I'll turn my cell phone off. I'll put on some good music and go for a drive. This is hard to explain to your family sometimes. My son wanted me to go and pick up his friend George the other day. There was no school for parent-teacher conferences, so he could come over and play. I told him no, that I was too busy, that I had too much work to do. Well, I didn't realize I was being watched. I work from home. So she has a wonderful house. She's an amazing, amazing person. And by the way, if you ever wanted to reach out to her, I know she would answer those emails. She's incredible. He monitored every move that day. And by the end of the day, he said, quote, real hard day at work, Mom. You went on a drive, you went to get coffee, you listened to that freaking Michael Bublé Christmas song like 10 times. I even saw you getting on Facebook. And I didn't know what to say because he was right. By all outward appearances, I was doing absolutely nothing. So the point is, as self-employed individuals, we're always doing something for our work, whether it's that time that we want to just sort of block out and think about things. But some people just don't understand that, I think. And then also, I'll just leave with this. The art guys are a very funny, collaborative team, actually. These two men who live in Houston, they have their own families, they have children, they're married, but they have been a professional working team for a long time. And on page 177, they say at the end, business, capitalism, branding, marketing, and advertising are ingrained in the American culture. As artists, we consider it our duty to investigate, experiment with, and question all of this. For many years, we have done so, and now we think we're finally getting somewhere. May we give you our card? They're very funny. So in this book, there's a lot of humor. There's a lot of intimacy, just as these wonderful artists have shared. So now I'd like to open it up to the audience, all of you. And if we can pass around a microphone, maybe. Where's Matt? Maybe we can pass around a microphone or something. Don or Matt, and would you mind, because if we've had that, we can keep the microphone here.
We don't have to do everything.
Thank you. Yes, you do. Okay, does anybody have any questions? And if you don't, I can just keep talking, can you tell? any burning? Yes, that I love your shirt.
Thank you.
That is awesome.
This is a personal comment. This is just a personal comment. I would like to thank Professor White. A few years ago, I was at ATI informally covering events because my wife was a participant. and I was using my new camera and having trouble, and Professor White very graciously helped me get some good photographs. So thank you, Professor White.
Thank you. Anybody else want to say anything to the rest of the panelists? Yes, sir.
There you go.
How do you put a price on your artwork?
That's a great question. Who do you want to ask that of? All of everybody?
All of them.
Everybody. Julie, do you want to start? Because you show in galleries.
The time spent will never cover the cost.
Right. Briefly. It's a hard question. There's no regulation
or
science.
It's a really hard question. Yeah. Because, you know, when you're starting out, you know, here's the thing. You can never go down in price.
That's
you
right.
can always go up, but you can't go down. So
right.
you have to really be careful about pricing yourself out of any kind of market or sale. So just generally, I think my work is probably way underpriced. But my philosophy is that I would rather have my work be out there. I would rather have it be hanging in people's homes, and I'd rather have them own it. So I do what I can to make sure that that can happen. And when I have a gallery, I work with the gallerists to discuss pricing, but pretty much my pricing has pretty much stayed the same. And, you know, I give tons of discounts. I do a lot of trades with artists. But for me, it's more important that the work get out there and that it's not sitting there gathering dust in a storage facility someplace. But how do you come up with a price? It's really difficult. I think you have to really look around and see where similar artists are at your point in your career and kind of evaluate where do you fit in. Into that sort of marketplace.
That's exactly right.
My job is a little different because sometimes there is a certain amount of money there for a piece of art, public art. So the budget is there. It's something I can do.
Can you specify that? So when you apply for something, there's a specific budget already designated.
On
right?
most of the, yeah.
Because something
happened.
This song. Can you hear me there? Or
sure. Yeah, keep going.
So usually there is certain budgets, and the one thing that I have to do is make sure that to calculate exactly how much of my time is going to take, also like for materials and stuff. So I have to do the math and see that it's feasible for what I intend to do. To be honest, in most cases, it's like I really want to do this great thing out of proportion. There's no way I can do it with that budget. So I have to like refrain myself and try to accommodate what it is. That's one thing. The other one is like sometimes there are projects that I understand I actually won't be able to make any profit. I better be able to pay some bills and stuff. But I didn't have to work harder. I wanted to do it because there is other thing that normally changes. So I'm just like careful enough to decide what projects. Like on this case before, it might not be out of money, but I know it's gonna be out of exposure.
Right, so there's an exchange maybe.
So 2%.
Ken?
The advice that I had from my father, who was a business person, he said whoever names the price first loses. So that was kind of tough because people always ask you how much things are, and then you would say, well, what's your budget? And you kind of do that sort of dance. Public art projects are great because they usually specify how much you have to work with, so then you're competing not so much on price, but your idea. For a lot of the large-scale public art projects I do, I also work with fabricators. So there are people that I have to pay in order to get the work done as well. What has played out with my work is usually if there's a public art project, I will see that two-thirds of that will go to the fabrication cost. And I'm left with a third to kind of work out. So I kind of know how much I might be making on the job, given that. What's really great is one of the fabricators that I work with is a big studio over in Germany. And the owner of that factory oftentimes has given me a discount on the price of having my work fabricated. And the way that he looks at it is he's trying to get the best work out at his studio, the best design things. So he has this wonderful philosophy where he charges more for bad designs. So if someone's coming in with something really ugly that they want to have made, he charges a lot of money for that. And then he's able to take the profit from that and give it to the more promising designers that are making the better work. And I love that, so.
So I'm a little bit different than everyone else, and in a way fortunate, because I primarily produce work in a print format. And even though I have fairly small, limited editions, I get the sort of best of both worlds. So I can start out, as Julie described, with a price that I think is accessible and reasonable for the edition. And as the edition sells, I then make adjustments to the price, because I've gradually accumulated some income as something sells, as well as it starts to run out, I'm less concerned about whether I make an individual sale, and so I can offset the earlier lower prices with prices that rise as the edition goes along. So in my case, in many of them, it's 15, and so the first five are a certain price, the next five are a certain price. And the other piece that I, and because a number of the sales that I make are also with institutions, I have a sort of slightly different version of a discount with institutions in order to maintain the price. If an institution that I believe in and I want my work in, it doesn't really have the budget to purchase what they want, I often work out an arrangement where they purchase a certain number of pieces at full price, and with the understanding that I will donate other pieces so that they get all the work that they want, and I sort of walk this line between, you know, not actually lowering the price. But then I go a step further, and there are also organizations that I support for a variety of reasons, and they just get work from me. Not too long ago, Rick, which is an arts organization in Brooklyn, that was very supportive and showed work and was very generous in their support, then was having an auction to raise money, and I donated work to their auction so that they could, you know, help to, you know, raise money. And I've donated work to other organizations so that they could raise money, including my own institution. And I think that the thing to understand, too, that it's often complex, and it's part of the educational process. In some cases, most of the organizations that I work with understand this, but sometimes they don't, that artists don't get to deduct the value of a donation. We only get to deduct the cost of materials, yeah. Which is, you know, not really much. I usually don't even bother. So the important thing is to understand this relationship when organizations come to artists and ask for donations, is that that donation is a little bit different than the donation that if I happen to own one of Julie's paintings, I could now donate that, and I would now get the value that I have paid for it if I purchased that painting and I decide, well, I'm going to donate that to this college so that they can have it in auction. I'm going to get a different kind of tax deduction than if she gives her own painting in the same way. So that's another part of what happens for me as an artist, to try to support the community and at the same time strike a balance.
Can I just say one more?
Yeah, but I
want
to
I just want to say that there's a certain kind of artist up here, and there could be a very different kind of artist who would tell you very different things, that you need to be aggressive, that you need to be, you know, market yourself. So I think that that's, you know, a missing kind of,
we were talking about that,
you know, person that's sitting up here. But, you know, for me, money is not as important as getting the work out. For other people, having a market, sustaining it, marketing yourself, getting into this gallery, and then getting to the next gallery, and then sort of making this, like, progression up this quote-unquote ladder is very important. So this is not necessarily consensus. It's just the four people that you happen to have.
So to answer your question, I'm going to tell you pragmatically how you price your work. So the first thing is you have to, as Julia and Wendell were saying, you find your market. So you have to compare, you have to do research, you have to do the work to find out where does your market fit. What does that mean? It means the medium that you're working in, number one. It means your resume, how that compares to the level of where another artist is showing. Let's say you compare your level where you are, the experience that you have to another artist, if you're emerging or mid-career or established, and the kind of work you do, the size of the work that you do. Every market's different. Painting and drawing is different, then prints is drawing, then photography, then sculpture, then site-specific work, performance, and installation. They're all different. So to be able to get also comparisons in place of different artists, different galleries, and people ask advice of different people who are out there who have that experience, like ours, an institution, to be able to make that a judgment for you. But there, it's a science, and there's no regulation in the art world, so it's very gray. So, anyway, other questions?
Like figuring out how to price your house.
Hi, good afternoon. The excerpt you read from your book begs a question. We as artists expect others to understand our work. I'd like to turn that around, and how do we, as artists, who like the panel to respond to that, how do you reach out to others in your social, personal life, family members, to understand their life on the other side of how they may be viewing you, and how do you invite them into your world?
Right. That's a great question, which actually needs to happen so much more of artists in this day and age, because I think a lot of artists are so insular that they don't allow for that to happen. So I think it's a great question. Who wants to start answering that question? Thank you.
Yeah, I try to be a little bit of a chameleon, so I try to interview my clients and find out what is an area that we may have in common. And that's what I'll try to make the piece about. When I do public art projects, I spend a lot of time going into the community and learning about the history of the community and the people that are part of it, and then make the piece about that. So I do feel like and I already mentioned that I became an educator because I was explaining what I do. So I think that one of the big components that I also tell young people when they're interested in the arts, I said it's very important to be able to write well, to be able to describe what you do, and you have to be able to explain, because you're constantly going to be defending and explaining what you do
right.
to whatever circle you're in.
Okay. I just have to keep rolling, you guys. I don't mean to be rude, and I'm sorry to say, I warned you guys, but I'm sure there are a lot of questions here, so I want to just keep it going. So,
for instance, I work from a massive level, like really huge pieces. I rely on collaboration. So for me, like, I mean, the answer is like, it's so easy for me to step into other people's life and then bring all these people into our life. Because every other project offers this opportunity, offers change. So that way I can, I'm just lucky that we get a chance to collaborate well. So anybody who's going to come to this, we expose it out there, we let people know that anybody can bank, anybody can be part of it.
So the invitation is what, how to connect?
I would say that education is really important, and I think that everyone in here who's a voter needs to put their vote to work and vote to keep arts in public schools,
yes.
and vote to keep our arts councils functioning and not having budgets cut at every single step of the way. And I think that when kids grow up knowing that art is a part of everyday life, that they know.
Just to clarify, you're saying the question is that how do you convince your family members?
Your family members. If you're talking about sustainability.
Right.
You're an artist.
Right.
If your family doesn't know what you're doing.
Right.
When you pass away, they throw your stuff in the trash.
Yeah, well, you can create a will to protect yourself, number one. So, okay, so you can do that. Okay, before that, okay. But let's get more specific. So can you answer that?
Well, for me, it has been a conversation. I think that I work with a lot of a very wide range of students and I see what they go through all the time, over the years, having these kinds of conversations with their family. I just recently worked with a student who is married and has children that are fairly grown, and the whole family is homeless and lives in a hotel room, and he's continuing to work on pursuing his art. And his family supports him, his wife, his daughter, his son, and they believe in what he's doing, and they believe that they want him to continue, and he works in a Wawa to, you know, try so they have a little bit of money, and they're struggling. And at the same time, I would say that it's also that willingness to have those conversations, to talk and to just sort of, as others have said, even from the community point of view, to invite family members into the world that you're involved in, so that if it's really making family members central to openings and exhibitions, so that they feel a part of and recognized as part of the support system that is, you know, part of what happens. I've been fortunate that the recent book, but in a previous book, you know, I always, you know, mention, particularly my wife, but, you know, family in general, but that my wife is in the list of funders, because it's our income together that helps support what we do. It's, I mean, even the money that I make that I use towards my artwork is money that, you know, could go towards, you know, a vacation in Tahiti instead. And so her generosity in saying, yes, no, this is where we should put the money is part of that. You know, she's a funder as well.
I think also I'll just add that from my experience with my parents still not understanding what I do, and I'm 51 years old, and I make a living as an artist, that I think that the best case scenario is to be able to find nuggets of them, of what you can figure out that they can relate to. So to understand what they'll talk, whether it's finance or some other way, to be able to, the artist has to do the work to figure out, like Ken was saying, what's the other person thinking about that we can make, speak the same language and make a crossover to understand. But sometimes, and I'm sure all of us who've been teaching and know a lot of people, students who parents never understand, you just have, it's proven by what you do, by example. Other
Sharon,
questions?
We got a question over here first.
Yeah, good afternoon, ma'am. I had a question, it could be a general question, but specifically for Julie Langston. Do you set aside any artwork kept privately or kept undisclosed for the purpose of a legacy or even for an estate for later in your life?
No.
Later.
No, I mean, here's the thing. I try to, I have work that my family owns that I know that, you know, will be around. I try to make sure that my work goes to people that really care for it. And that sort of makes me understand that it's not going to get thrown into the trash. You know, people who appreciate it, they may not have the kind of money that would be nice for me to get for my paintings, but people who really, really, really want something will tend to take good care of it. And I, you know, when I'm not here, what am I going to do? I mean, I don't know. None of us can be here in, like, you know, 100 years. So, you know, we don't have control over that. I'd rather have someone enjoy it while it's, you know, doing nothing if it's just sitting in my studio.
There is a question over here.
This is kind of a wish question. I'm local. I'm here. I'm in Cumberland County, and I kind of have a real quick math that I don't have a job. I'm a full-time artist, but I do have a small gallery. I have 25 artists. None of my 25 artists have jobs. We're all nuts. But I have people come in, and I have to educate everybody. And I often wish, and the colleges, this one and a lot of the local ones, they send the students in for reports on art. But one of the things and this is, please take no offense. One of the things I find that some of the educators have never taught their students is how math works for us, those of us who do not have jobs. And I'll say, the piece is $85. Gallery takes 40%, not mine, but 40%. I'm down to $51. My framer charged me 30. No, it's not expensive. Well, how much am I supposed to do with this $21 for that piece? And I just feel that if the schools or art appreciation or some educators, I'm self-employed, why can't, and they want to know how to price their work. Do any of you have a formula in your head how to put this out there? I would even like the general public to understand, non-artists, non-students, understand when you look at something for $85, the artist is down to 21.
I just want to answer this first, if you don't mind, because I'm going to, I love that question. After teaching professional development for all of these years, and one reason why I produced this book, not many schools do teach professional development because some of the artists in those schools don't feel, I mean, meaning faculty, don't feel it's necessary. So it's an internal prop, right, exactly. What is that about? So it's getting better though, because there are private organizations, funding organizations like the Tremaine Foundation, the Joe Mitchell Foundation, Creative Capital. I work for Joe Mitchell Foundation and Creative Capital that do the outreach to have artists learn these things outside of the institution. The Tremaine Foundation actually funded, and they've stopped doing this now, many schools across the country to have seed money to start professional development, where then if after a few years, then the school would then adopt it, and then they would be able to fund those programs. But this is, it's getting better and better. It's a great question. When I was at Yale, I had zero of that, and then I had all that debt. I had to figure that out myself. So I think that that is a huge, huge thing, the budgeting. How do you budget, like figuring out a public art project? How do you budget a sale? How do you do all those things like a small business should do? And I do think it's getting better. I think the best case scenario is that these tenured faculty, sorry you guys, but I have to say this, tenured faculty who come from a different generation, a different way of thinking, generally, they need to either adopt or go forward, and then a newer generation who need for that to happen, they can adopt it and then go forward in teaching these things, or at least that other generation can learn how important it is to be able to adopt it. But that those internal politics are very alive and well right now, and I do think that they need to change. So I had to say that before, but to frame this, I wanted to ask all of you also to comment on that.
Well, I mean, I think it has changed. I think it's much better than it was. I was at school even before Sharon, and I don't think I even ever learned how to write a resume, how to take slides of my work, how to present myself as an artist. There was an expectation that I would be out there doing it for 20 years before I ever even set foot in a gallery to ask someone to look at what I was doing.
Yeah.
So the world has completely changed. And I know in my school we do professional practices, and it's part of the curriculum. And I think it just takes some time. When you have kids in art history class coming into a gallery, that's a totally another thing. I mean, they're not going to get that kind of education that you're talking about. But in a fine arts program, you should be getting that at this point in time.
Totally.
I would just add that that is, there are a range of broad cultural issues in which we need to have these conversations, not just in the value of this one particular product. I think that there is a whole range of different ways in which we have uncertainty about the value of a particular thing or a service. And so that's also a bigger conversation. But I agree, we have incorporated professional practice and those kinds of things into what we're doing in our art classes as well. I would just add that I'm not sure that, and I also came up at a time when it wasn't necessarily given as part of the academic experience that I had as an artist, but I'm not sure that it necessarily rings true yet for an 18, 19, 20, 21 year old.
That's a good point.
That is not yet paying their own cell phone bill. So there's a range, there's a big set of ideas that are involved in the evolution of maturing and developing, and I also hold on to those ideas loosely in relationship to my students because I recognize that I'm going to say things and do things that don't seem to register that may, you know, have an impact later on, and there's a trajectory involved in that process. And it's not to say that we're off the hook, but it's just to say that it's not always something that is solvable because of a bigger range of problems.
I know, but I think that's a great point. However, I think the point is too that it should just be a given anyway, because they may not register at that time, but if they have the information, they can register later.
Right. Has to be there, register later.
You know, this goes back to another point, which I know you think wasn't towards your point, but we don't value culture in this country.
Right.
And we have to do something about that in a broader level. And it's about who we elect, it's about what we choose for our school districts, it's about what we promote in our own homes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, countries in Europe have very, you know, robust cultural programs, and we need to understand in the United States that this is an important part of our cultural life.
Totally agree. And our economic life. Exactly.
I gotta be honest. I really think that this country also has so much to offer to artists. I really think there are so many things to do. There are so many offers. Like this day comes to offer so many things.
Right.
I guess it's a matter of it's just like any other job. You have to try harder. I guess you have to offer new things. You have to try to convince the client. I believe that somehow we have to. I guess it helps a lot when you develop network, when you collaborate with don't be surprised if in the future we do a project together. Because I don't know anything about GLAAD, but I have idea how to incorporate GLAAD. You might do that, but
that would be amazing.
It's just a matter of because the goals are out there, and it's just you have to look and you have to learn. The key is exposed out there. For all these artists, exposed out there, the fans you are. Show the best of you and take your case out. And there is a lot of program foundation that can help you to take this out so a lot of more people can see your programs. And when they have to shoot, they're going to shoot you because that's exactly what they want.
Ken, do you have anything brief to add?
Just to sum it up, I would say education is the most important thing, and if it's not being supplied, then you have to be the advocate.
I know, I think it's great that you have this situation where, I mean, not the situation that everybody has to learn, but that the fact that you give it, so you should be applauded for that. But I do think that there are organizations now that can fill the gap, and it's just a matter of those artists knowing what those organizations are and then subscribing to that. Other questions? Yeah. I saw you too.
I'm familiar with Fine Art America, and was just curious about any other internet resources that might be available for artists to help them promote what they're doing.
In what way? I'm not familiar with that. So.
Fine Art America is a website where different artists, you can be paintings, drawings, photography, you can have it in different formats and offer it for sale. And create your own virtual type galleries.
Do you have, Artsy, Etsy, what else is there? You guys, do you know? Internet? If you give me your email, I'll send you a list.
Okay, thank you.
I do cafe.
Cafe, right. Call for artists.
A lot of corporate artists use that. So.
Is it callforentry.org? That's it.
Yes.
Callforentry.org. Right. That's really great. Don? No, this woman had first.
I mostly had a question as an emerging artist or someone who's coming new into it in self-promotion. At what point do you feel that you need a digital presence when, you know, a 10-year-old can have a digital presence for your artwork? You know, as far as promoting yourself and how, like, is it something that's just gives
100, 500,000%.
Yes, I mean, everybody has one, so do you really have to have it?
Yes. Do you guys want to say anything about that? You all have a digital, right?
You know, they now have website services where they're templates. You know, if you as long as you have a body of work, you can get a website. You just need to register your domain name, and it's really simple. You can do it yourself. You don't have to know anything about programming. You have to be on the web. You don't exist.
But do you feel it just gives you validity to, yes, here's my work, and here's where you can
do it?
It
makes it easier for people to have access to your work, period. It's information.
Yeah. For better or for worse, our culture celebrates individuality and collectors and people that are interested in maybe buying your work want to know what your story is. So that's the most important reason for having it out there, not just to see your work, but it's becoming, again, more important to be able to write blog about the work.
Right.
Some people use like the traditional .com address as just a static format where there's pieces, but then more and more it's about the blog where you're writing or you're tweeting and you're doing all that kind of stuff. So unfortunately you don't just need your website, you need to tweet, you need Facebook, you need all that other stuff too. And I find that to be a little overwhelming. So because there isn't enough time to do your work and to do everything else, but people do all that stuff.
Go ahead.
So, I would just say that, I mean, I think that that's the question that, you know, business people will be able to answer easily, even in the pre-internet era, which is that there's a certain degree to which marketing and advertising doesn't always generate a immediate sale, but a lack of it is bad as well. And so it's partly this odd relationship that that kind of marketing presence has. I would say that the important piece is, and this is a critical piece, is to try and manage that amount of time. And at the same time, not do too little, not do too much. And you know, some people will say 20% maybe, and there are different opinions about the percentage of time, but 8% of time, you know, needs to be, you know, put into that presence. I love what Ken said about the story. I have gotten lots of opportunities and to do different things through my web presence, through my social media presence, because people know me, and then it begins a conversation. It may be a lecture, it may be the purchase of work, a whole range of different things. I just sold work to a collection that found my work through a website, and at the end of the sale, they were going through some of their files, and they realized that I had sent them a CD like 6 years ago. And they were apologizing because they were like, oh, we didn't realize. And it reinforced for me exactly what the problem was.
Sister, do you have anything to add?
Honestly, I'm kind of behind on media.
Oh.
To be honest, I have a website, and I lost it somehow, and I made the process of doing it.
Do you think it's still there?
Probably not. But I rely on Facebook, but to be honest, it's very important. Sad to say, it's very important. As we speak, I have to probably go back home and try to just get more of this free internet space that you get. Because as we speak, I got a call to do a collaboration with an architecture firm. They have to do some renew on an overpass, and they need a mural component. And I'm sure. So say, send your website. And right now I have a website.
See?
So I sent a couple of links. They actually were able to submit some, but I think it needs to be more formal.
I want to say this too, that the content by which you are active in social media is just as important. The people who just self-promote, people ignore them. So social media is social, which means exchange. So it means liking somebody else's work or saying something about somebody else's work or taking a picture of what you've seen. Or like I do this lecture series at the New York Academy of Art, and I interview a lot of people, a lot of dealers. And I ask that question, what do you look for? They say, like the Meredith and Allegra from Sargent's Daughters, which is a gallery, and you can see that online in the New York Academy of Art, it's there. I asked them that question, they said, show us pictures of things that give you, that give us insight into yourself. So it goes back to Ken, but like Instagram, for example, they find people on Instagram all the time. I found people to curate a show on Instagram because I couldn't get to all the studios. So I think that it's conscious social media, and it's not just promotion. Promotion doesn't just mean putting your work out there. It means a whole host of things. I just had to add that.
Thanks. My question is about recognition, but not in a big, broad recognition sense, because I think it's really just a bunch of little recognitions. I was just wondering if each of you had like one moment in your life where either a stranger, a mentor, a student, a client, someone said something to you that just made you light up inside and say like, yes, I'm doing something that matters, this is important, somebody gets it. I'm sure you have more than one, but anybody?
What do you guys
think?
All of you guys can say something.
I think we all can say something like that, right? Because the public exposure that I get that all the time. Not just from the people who participate, which is in the thousands now, a lot of people have been able to be part of the process, but on a daily basis, people just walking by, they make positive comments. So far, I haven't had any negative, really. Like, who doesn't like something where, you know, you are making a nice, decent piece of work, but not just that, inviting people to be part of the creative process.
One of the things that I do is just the nature of the medium that I work in is I do pieces that are memorials for other people who passed away. That can be very satisfying too. Like I really feel like I guess some people walk the planet and they don't really know why they're here. And I do feel like I know why I'm here. So that's, I get a lot of satisfaction from that.
But Ken, I think he was asking about specific moments, right? Like, is that what you're asking? Can you give a specific moment?
I did a large memorial window at a nursing home facility, and the theme of it was kind of regeneration, and it had a lot of figures in it. And I included a figure of a woman carrying a small child, and I didn't really think that much about it, but later somebody told me that they had been contemplating the window and felt like that helped them to have some closure about a child that passed away. And they shared that story with me. It wasn't even something I had even put in the work, consciously thought about. And I do really feel like, as an artist, that a lot of times I'm just a vessel or an instrument that inspiration or, you know, the muse or some sort of God really like plays through. And you know, you're making yourself available to that. That's very satisfying when you know that that's happening.
That's great. Julie?
I guess there's two kinds of recognition. One is as a teacher and one is as an artist. And I think I get the recognition as a teacher often. I have students who I maintain relationships with and who have shared with me how meaningful it has been that I've been, you know, mentoring them. But I have to say, one thing stands out as an artist. I remember being in line at some museum to pick up a ticket for some event. And the young girl at the counter, I told her my name. She said, I know your work. You know, so for me, that was like this huge thing that there was this young person who I didn't know, who knew what I did. So that was like the greatest thing ever.
I have to add also that the relationship with the students and the, and that those moments that come often at the end of, you know, when it's time to graduate, and the kind of statements that I've gotten from students at that moment, that's when they feel comfortable to sort of express something more emotional with me. Those are important. But in my household, the division of labor is such that I don't particularly care for cleaning, but I like food shopping. So I do most of the food shopping, and really some of my favorite moments are like when the vegetable manager has read an article about me and wants to talk about my work. And yeah, I mean, I've been stuck sometimes 20 minutes in the vegetable aisle, you know, talking about, because my work overlaps with history, and so they, you know, there's that other side to it that then, you know, starts conversations in that way. So that is, so I, what is, I, what I guess I'm saying is that those moments when it travels outside the art world, when somebody who is not following the art world and, or, you know, things that, the type of things that I do, connects with what I do and wants to have a conversation.
Other questions?
Sure. Do you think that we could...
We have 5 minutes.
5 minutes?
Yeah, is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine. We're ready when you are.
So how about if we have one more question?
Okay.
You're the one. No pressure.
Some volunteer work with a nonprofit gallery, and when artists bring work in...
Can you go to the microphone? I can hear you.
I do some work with a nonprofit gallery, just a little bit of promotion. When artists bring their work in, oftentimes they have no promotion to help us promote them. What advice would you give to an artist when they bring their work in to help the gallery, to help them get their name out?
Well, I can answer that, but you
two,
you guys.
Well, I mean, I work hard at just doing the kinds of things, as I've said along the way, that businesses do, and, you know, maintaining my mailing list and, you know, sharing and becoming a partner with whatever organization I'm working with, using the social media piece so that even in there where, you know, it may impact something that I'm doing, I try to then share about what the other, what the organization is doing, what the institution is doing, and I think, oh, I, you know, met up with somebody or a group that I think is really doing great stuff. So I just use those pieces. I try to be a partner in that process.
Sharon, since I met Sharon has been the most amazing thing in my life, which is she's really up the ante in sort of how I keep in touch with people. She responds to every email, she responds to every card, she handwrites cards in a day. I mean, she's the only one I get a handwritten card from. But I think that every artist needs to have a resume, an artist statement, you know, a list of people that they would potentially use as a mailing list, an email list, a Facebook presence, because Facebook is this huge thing for the art world for some reason, I don't know. But it is, and yeah, it's free.
I think one of the things that a gallery can do, or people who sponsor artist work, is to do as much as they can to promote this person's work on media. TV is very important. So, try to convince all the people out there, convince them to make a story about this particular person that you are going to expose on your gallery. That helps a lot. Once you are on radio or TV, that helps a lot for him to sell, and that will benefit everybody, I think.
Yeah, the only other thing I would add to that is video is becoming more and more important in order for you to hear the voice of the artist, for them to tell their story. So, you know, find a young film person and hire them to work for you, and, or, you know, just to film them, you know, film.
Does that answer your question, or are you defeated by that?
Not quite. What I'm getting at is I have people
come to me and want me to promote them, but give me no information.
Right, but it's their responsibility to do that. So they should, you should, I would write a checklist for them to say all the things that Julie was saying, everybody on the panel. But then also, I think the key to getting outreach out is to do the research to get a great mailing list, because that's everybody's currency. So then it becomes like breathing. If you send an announcement out and you've done the research of who that audience is, who fits with that artist or your program, then opportunities just come by making that match. And so for me, I do research every day, 15 minutes a day. And if you want, I can send you my resource guide. It's 12 pages long. And that can jumpstart your research. And it's like exercising. 15 minutes a day, that's it. 15 minutes a day looking at these guides and websites and figure out who matches. And my email list is 19,000 people for an individual. So that those 19,000 people, I don't have to do an outreach. I've already done the work so that every time I send an email out, 2 to 3 times a year, I get an opportunity. And then I get to not only date those people, I get to actually, maybe I'm already happily married, but metaphorically, be married to them and have a long life and experience with them. But it comes with trying to target who's the audience? Who defines your vision? And then having that currency. So I think that the artists should come to you. You should provide them maybe with a checklist and steer them as to what is good for you. And then you should also build your mailing list to foster that promotion. And that doesn't take money. It takes time and it takes smart to figure out where you want to go and how to target those people.
But also, as a nonprofit, I mean, we are really lucky in New Jersey. We have the New Jersey State Arts Council, which many states don't have an arts council even. I mean, every arts council needs more money, but we have one.
Right.
And as a nonprofit, I used to be on the board of a nonprofit. We would do requests for proposals. If you do them like every few months or once a year, you get to send out a list of a checklist of what you would like artists to submit when you're going to look at their work. And you shouldn't look at their work if they don't have a resume and they don't have a statement. Don't look at it. Say, I can't look at this. How could I look at it? The other thing is that there are funds from the council, from other nonprofits, to have workshops for the artists in your area on how to present a portfolio, how to work on a website, how to present yourself as an artist to a gallery. And I've sat on a lot of those kinds of review committees. We would just, you know, schedule 20-minute meetings, you know, for a whole day. People will bring their portfolio in. You get someone to say, well, I think you need to fix your resume this way. I think it would be helpful if you did this, 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 and this. And I think that those workshops are really, really helpful for the community.
And I do know that there is a certain section of the population that lives kind of vicariously through the lives of the artists that they come in contact with. So, you know, I've been able to, you know, some of the things you talked about in terms of reducing what things cost you to have done. You know, if your accountant, places like, you know, people can help you because they just want to help you. So if you really say, I don't know how to write a resume, go to someone and say, please help me. So it's, I think oftentimes we don't get what we need because we really don't ask. And a lot of people are very generous with their time.
So I just want to thank Matt and Don very, very much for having us. I want to thank all of these of these wonderful artists to be here to answer your questions privately. So they're right, you guys are open and ready and you're holding your arms out, right? And then Julie and I are going to sign your books if you like, and you can also have an opportunity. And those people who I said I could send you a list or what have you, just give me your email, but give me like 3 days because I have to travel tomorrow. So I would totally be helpful. I will totally do it. It's a short life, so I will totally do it. I say what I do. So thank you all very much. I really appreciate it.
And this now is usually my favorite part of any event, the food. We have a lot of it, and it's delicious, and we have beverages, including locally craft beer and wine out in the foyer.
Wow.
So you're encouraged to enjoy yourselves, interact with the artists, mingle. Also, I do want to invite Donna for just a second from State Council on the Arts. They are our partner in funding this event, and we couldn't do it without them. And
yeah.
Donna.
Matt, thank you. It's been great collaborating with you on this project and with Sharon, and I'd like to thank the artists for attending today and for all of you taking time out of your schedules to come and participate in today's program. I want to briefly mention that I brought some flyers on the programs and services that the State Arts Council provides individual artists, which is out at the registration table.